Hachette Audio presents A Brief History of the Pacific, The Great Ocean by Jeremy Black, read by Roger Davis. Preface. Making the mighty Atlantic appear small, the Pacific is the great ocean, indeed the greatest on Earth. The time it takes to cross remains different to that of other oceans, and the psychological weight of the Pacific is more profound and more challenging to both imagination and experience. There are many problems in writing the history of the Pacific. Scale is one, but another is that the model of Atlantic history, a history that is more developed than that of the Pacific, is not really helpful. In part, this is a matter of scale, and the related problem with offering a narrative of convergence. Related to this, the idea of unrelated parallel developments on widely separate shores is only so helpful. In comparison to the Atlantic, the timetables, in the shape both of indigenous presence on the far more numerous islands in the Pacific and of Western control or influence over the islands and shores, are very different. As a consequence, there is a bigger overlap of these societies. The Western coastal and oceanic presence began in the 16th century with the Spanish takeover of the coasts of Central America, Colombia, Ecuador, Peru, and part of the Philippines. But despite a Russian presence from the 1630s, there was no subsequent advance for European power in the Pacific until the late 18th century. As a result, there was a considerable overlap between the Western presence and the continued vitality of indigenous societies. The Pacific can be divided between the four quadrants of the ocean, which, if the meridian was seen to go through Honolulu, with the top at the North Pole, would accordingly be northeast towards North America, southeast towards South America, northwest towards Asia, and southwest towards Australasia, and this designation will be adopted. There is also the conventional grouping, with reference to regions, devised in the 19th century, that of Melanesia, Micronesia, and Polynesia, which in practice do not cover all of the ocean, notably much of the North Pacific. All three regions, alongside Australasia, are regarded as part of Oceania, and Oceania is usually taken to extend as far east as Easter Island. But the United Nations has excluded from its definition the possessions of non-Oceania states, thus, for example, leaving out the Bonin Islands, Hawaii, Easter Island, and the Juan Fernandez Islands, which belong to Japan, the United States, Chile, and Chile again, respectively. Recent organisations repeatedly reflect the tensions of commission and omission, thus the World Rugby Pacific Nations Cup was first held in 2006 as the Pacific Five Nations. It included New Zealand, Fiji, Japan, Samoa, and Tonga. But the composition has been far from fixed. Australia only played in 2007 to 2008, and New Zealand has not participated since 2009. In turn, Canada and America joined in 2013. Like other oceans, there is the question repeatedly not only of the islands within the ocean, but also of the coasts. In this respect, furthermore, there is the question of how far the Pacific should be subordinated to differences based on the land masses to each side, as when the pro-Japanese-German geopolitician Karl Haushofer presented the leading pan-regions as pan-Europa, pan-Asian, and pan-America, the second designated for Japan, with an extension into the southern hemisphere. The Pacific, therefore, became a sphere of struggle between Japan and America, prefiguring the current emphasis on China and America. At all events, there is a considerable difference between treating the Pacific in terms of islands, or islands and coastlines, and, if only islands, which are to be included. For example, Japan and the Philippines each contrast greatly, not only within and between each other, but also with those in Polynesia. All too often the idea of the Pacific is one of Polynesia, with possibly a concession to Micronesia and even Melanesia, But there are many other islands in the Pacific, notably in the North Pacific. They provide different ideas, not least with the realities of cold seas. This issue is much more of a challenge than in the case of the Atlantic. In the case of the Pacific, the coasts include coastal islands, such as the Aleutians, Japan and New Zealand, each of which is an archipelago, as well as continental coastlines on the ocean, such as those of North and South America and Asia. There is a separate problem in the southwest quadrant, as both Indonesia and Australia are composed of islands, but particularly the former are peripheral to the Pacific, not least with an important presence on the Indian Ocean. As far as this audiobook is concerned, there will not be a history of Japan or California or Peru or Australia, but an engagement with their interaction with the Pacific, notably in terms of migration, trade, fishing, and power projection. Aside from these issues of span, there is also the conceptual one, and as the Fijian academic Epele Hauofa pointed out, there is a difference between the Pacific as islands in a far sea and, on the other hand, a sea of islands, the second appearing both more holistic and with more of an emphasis on the islands and the links between them created by voyaging rather than the surrounding powers. Although there was the earlier link in the shape of bounty bars, the taste of paradise, I would like to thank all those who sponsored my visits from 1992 to the Pacific, and those who travelled with me. It has been very stimulating and great fun, but, as the Pacific so often is, a reminder of other voyages that could have been taken. After four trips to Hawaii in 2003 to 2005, during one of which, in a memorable occasion for me, I lectured on the deck of the Missouri in Pearl Harbor on why the Allies won World War II, I was offered a job. I considered it, but knew that it would not have worked for the family. However, I often wonder, what if? I owe a great debt to Stephen Roger Fisher, Peter Hoffenberg, Patrick Manning, Paul Moon, Valerie Munt, Jeff Rice, and Mark Stocker, who kindly commented on an earlier draft. Gregory Cushman, Bill Gibson, Robert Guyver, Carlos Tromben, and John Wise answered questions. Zoe Bohm has been a most supportive editor, and Alison Griffiths a very helpful copy editor. This audiobook is dedicated to David Aboulafia, the world's leading maritime historian. I first heard him lecture when an undergraduate in the 1970s, and many years later was fortunate enough to lecture with him on a cruise. We are fellow members of the Athenaeum, and his acceptance of the dedication has given me great pleasure. Beveridge Reef. Any visitor to an ocean has their favourite memory. Mine is of Beveridge Reef, which is really in the middle of nowhere, about 130 miles from Niue, within the exclusive economic zone of which it lies, and 600 from the Cook Islands. Named after the ship that first reported it in 1847, it is submerged, other than at low tide, when a very small part is visible, and on that portion, smaller than my study at home, a few of us stood, savouring the sheer surprise of the experience. The remains of a fishing vessel that had run aground on the submerged reef were visible, and otherwise nothing. Ocean and sky stretched for what seemed millennia. Palmerston Atoll. A visit to a tiny sandy islet on a coral atoll in the Cook Islands is an encounter with the progeny of William Masters, 1831 to 1899, a ship's carpenter from inland Leicestershire who arrived at the uninhabited atoll in 1863 with two Polynesian wives, to whom he subsequently added a third, all from Tongariva. Masters had at least 23 children, and their descendants own and govern the island, which was annexed by Britain in 1891 and has been under New Zealand from 1901. Most of his descendants live in New Zealand or on Rarotonga, but others on Home Island, the only inhabited part of Palmerston Atoll. There are issues with past inbreeding, but also a sense of distinctive Anglophile community on the other side of the world. One a long way away, in an extraordinarily beautiful and only infrequently visited setting. Chapter 1. Introduction. A visit to Rabaul, its volcano observatory, and the devastation wreaked by successive earthquakes is a stark reminder that the Pacific is a play of potential physical forces. Storms, earthquakes, and volcanoes have long contrived to make navigation and settlement variously fatal, hazardous, and difficult. The Rim of Fire is a reminder in language of this drama of new outcomes. As an area to sail, the ocean has other challenges. The scale, not least the mismatch between distances and specks of land, ensures that many areas can only be sailed to or between by those outside such a site. And some of these distances are very great, notably so in the northern and southeast Pacific. This poses major challenges for navigation and ship supplies of both food and water. There is also the cultural challenge of the Pacific. There was often bitter rivalry within islands and island groups, but separately, the very isolation of the ocean helped ensure the development of different cultures, and this isolation and these differences posed particular issues of comprehension and acceptance. Geology provides a long, distinctive history, with the Pacific developing in the Mesozoic era, 252 to 66 million years ago, from the Panthalassic Ocean, the super-ocean that surrounded the supercontinent Pangaea. The Pacific originated about 190 million years ago from the centre of this ocean, with the origins of the Pacific Plate east of the Mariana Trench. The plate expanded at the expense of the three plates that met in this area, each of which then subducted or moved underneath surrounding continents, where they helped to cause volcanic instability, as with the Aleutian Islands, where the Pacific plate moves under the North America plate. These processes continue. The Coast Miwok people of Pacific California believe that the Earth started with land from the Pacific. Mariana Trench, first sounded in 1875 by the Challenger expedition and echo-sounded by Challenger 2 in 1951, the deepest oceanic trench on Earth is 200 kilometres, or 125 miles, east of the Mariana Islands. About 2,500 kilometres long, the trench has a confirmed depth of up to 11,000 metres in the Challenger Deep, which is greater than the height of Mount Everest. The water pressure at that depth ensures a far greater atmospheric pressure than at sea level. Microbial life forms have been observed, including large-celled amoebas. Snailfish have also been found. However, microplastics have been found, as well as carbon-14 from nuclear bomb testing. The depth of the trench has encouraged its being featured in imaginative fiction. A British warship, the Challenger, was loaned to the Royal Society of London for scientific purposes, and from 1872 to 1876 it sailed the oceans, surveying and investigating. The Challenger entered the Pacific in June 1874, leaving the ocean in January 1876 in what was an oceanographic cruise that helped develop the subject as a scientific discipline, as well as providing many biological specimens. It had been assumed that the deep sea would provide instances of missing links in the evolutionary process, not least acellular protoplasms, but this did not prove the case. Professor Challenger was the name Arthur Conan Doyle gave to his resolute scientific explorer. Volcanic action in a variety of forms was responsible for the Pacific Islands, including mantle plumes, as with Hawaii, Samoa, and Easter Island. In the case of Hawaii, the plume of magma from the hot spot remains stationary, but due to continental drift northwestward, a chain of islands is created, as the Pacific plate moves over the spot. To a degree, there is a continuation in the submarine emperor seamounts. Prominent volcanic peaks in Polynesia include those on Mo'orea, Bora Bora and Uahuka in the Marquesas. Very differently, volcanic action was responsible for atolls, where coral growth, that of coral polyps, animals that secrete calcium carbonate, leads to reefs after volcanoes sink, as in the Cook, Solomon and Tahiti archipelagos, for example Tupai in the last. Their low relief makes them very vulnerable to changes in sea level, and thus to climate warming. Coral contributes to the hazards posed to inshore navigation. Coastal approaches to many islands are treacherous, partly due to reefs, but with sandbars also not helpful. Thus, the Pandora sank in 1791 on the Great Barrier Reef when bringing back the Bounty mutineers who had been captured on Tahiti. Limited information on these hazards was frequently also a problem, so also with the limited docking that ensured a reliance on beachside lighterage. Major volcanic eruptions have included those in Niafo'u in the Tongan archipelago in 1946 and on Emberim in the New Hebrides in 1951. In 2020, the Calabarzon region of the Philippines was hit by the Taal volcano, which led tens of thousands to flee. On Hokkaido, the Showa Shinzan volcano was formed in 1943 to 1945. Volcanic eruptions in the eastern Pacific include that on the island of Socorro off Mexico in 1993. The Pacific has also seen the deepest undersea eruption yet recorded, the West Mata submarine volcano north of Tonga, erupting in 2009 at over 1,100 metres deep. In 2018, a tsunami hit Palau in Sulawesi after an earthquake, causing great devastation. So also with Japan, with a submarine earthquake in 2011, which moved the main island 2.4 metres to the east and caused a tsunami that led to a catastrophe at the Fukushima nuclear plant. Earthquakes are a major threat to California, where tectonic plates join. One in 1906 destroyed over 80% of San Francisco, killing about 3,000 people and making about 300,000 homeless. Another major one is in prospect. In 1906, there were also major earthquakes in the Aleutian Islands and Chile, while in 1939, an earthquake in the Chilean port of Concepcion killed about 28,000 people. Another earthquake and subsequent tsunami there in 2010 left many homeless in the city, but relatively few casualties. The Pacific plate does not cover the entire ocean, which contributes greatly to the geological complexity of the area. So also with the relationship between plates and continents, so that, for example, Zealandia, a largely submerged mass of continental crust, nearly as big as Australia, leaves above sea level New Zealand, New Caledonia, the Lord Howe Island Group, and Norfolk Island. The complex geology of the Pacific is partly responsible for often difficult conditions near its coasts, especially shoals, which were a particular problem for those unfamiliar with their waters. The situation did not really improve for Westerners until the mid-19th century. Not only were surveys important, but also the construction of lighthouses, for example, that on the Farallon Islands off San Francisco in 1853. We have already visited the question of definition in the preface, and that helps explain differences in the accounts of the scale of the Pacific. Yet there is no doubt of role. The Pacific, indeed, is the dominant central ocean in Athelstan Spilhouse's three-lobed composite shoreline map, which was first devised in 1942. It is safe to see the Pacific as covering one-third of the world's surface and to note its great distances, such as over 10,000 miles between Manila and Panama. To the north, there is a clear divide in the Bering Strait into the Arctic. In addition, South America's southwards length ensures that there are restricted entrances into the South Atlantic. And there are restricted passages north of Australia between the Pacific and Indian Oceans. However, in the south, there is no clear divide between the Pacific and the Southern Ocean. The last factor adds to the problem of describing the climate. It is overly easy to focus on that of the tropics, not least if commenting on Polynesia, and to ignore the far more difficult cases of the non-tropical North and South Pacific, where cold temperatures and strong westerly, i.e. from the west, winds are to the fore, notably the roaring 40s and furious 50s in the Southern Hemisphere. This could make entry into the Pacific from the South Atlantic difficult. William Bligh tried this course en route to Tahiti with the Bounty in 1787, but was repulsed by winds and storms and instead had to go by the lengthy route via the Cape of Good Hope. Komandorski Islands. The Pacific includes many islands that are far from Polynesia and very different to it. The Komandorski or Commander Islands, named after Commander Vitus Bering, are Russian, but geographically the westernmost of the Aleutian Islands, otherwise an American chain. With a maritime climate that involves high rainfall, which contributes to the large number of lichens and mosses, the islands have only a small human population, but there is a very large animal presence, notably of birds and sea life. In the tropics, in contrast, the trade winds blow for much of the year, from the east or northeast, north of the equator, and from the east or southeast to the south of the equator. They usually provide a relatively equable climate and consistent sailing conditions, to which navigators had to adapt. Thus, beginning in the late 16th century, the eastbound voyage of Spanish galleons from Manila to Acapulco took a great circle route, but the westbound voyage saw a more southerly track, in order to take advantage of the trade winds. However, if the trade winds are weak, an El Niño event arises, because warm waters can spread east from the western Pacific and limit the movement of cold, deep water northward along the Pacific coast of South America. This has a broader impact on global climate, as in 1997 to 1998, El Niño events see the water temperature off Peru rise considerably and are linked to changes in weather pattern. More generally, El Niño events interact with global warming, not least in causing drought in the Western Pacific, as in Fiji and Samoa. Moby Ducks, A Tale of Currents. In January 1992, 28,800 friendly flotees, yellow ducks, red beavers, blue turtles and green frogs, were washed overboard from a container ship en route from Hong Kong to Tacoma during a Pacific storm near the international dateline. Lacking hulls, unlike the 61,000 Nike running shoes that went overboard in 1990, the flotees did not sink and have become a way to study oceanic surface currents. Many came ashore on the northwest Pacific coast of North America as a result of the North Pacific Gyre, or circular current, but others turned south, going to Indonesia, Australia, or, less frequently, Hawaii and Chile. Some travelled, via the Bering Strait and Arctic pack ice, into the North Atlantic. The trade winds provide breezes that counter high temperatures, and also rain when they hit high slopes, for example on Oahu in the Hawaiian group, where the rainfall on the windward eastern slopes contrasts with the drier leeward rain shadow of the slopes. When the trade winds fail, humidity is acute, and there is much convection rainfall, both at sea and on the islands. The length of the wet season, however, varies, being longer, for example, on the Solomons than New Caledonia. The windward side of New Guinea has annual rainfall of up to 300 inches, particularly in the monsoon, which helps make rivers impassable and feeds large mangrove swamps. The situation is exacerbated by forest clearance, notably for tropical hardwoods. The rainy season can bring hurricanes and floods, as well as more insistent soil erosion, leaching and landslides. In contrast, the leeward side of New Guinea around the capital, Port Moresby, is dry from May to December. Voyaging was affected by storms, as with the private Japanese attempt to conquer Taiwan in 1616. 13 junks filled with warriors were wrecked by a storm. Only one ship reached the island, and the local population killed the crew. Hurricanes are known as typhoons in the Pacific. A typhoon hitting between Manila and Yokohama in 1908 badly disrupted and delayed the American Great White Fleet on its circumnavigation. In December 1944, Typhoon Cobra hit Task Force 38 east of Luzon in the Philippines, sinking three American destroyers. Lieutenant Thompson Webb on the carrier Nahenta Bay reported gusts of well over 100 miles per hour, waves rising to 70 feet and lifting the screws clear of the water, the barometer falling to 29.12, aircraft and many men lost overboard, seams on the ships opening, and fear. At the end, of the 100 or more that had been together, single vessels were scattered in all directions, with some ships that had rolled over as much as 72 degrees. I believed that I was seeing the wrath in the face of God. In 2013, Typhoon Haiyan killed over 7,000 in the Philippines. Pam, in 2015, was a real hazard in the South Pacific. And in 2018, Typhoon Mangkhut had gusts of up to 255 kilometers per hour in Luzon. In 2020, Typhoon Harold hit Vanuatu, damaging 21,000 houses. There was massive disruption in each case. Hurricanes tend to be less dramatic in the eastern Pacific, but Nora hit the Mexican coast hard in 1997. Rainfall is linked to vegetation, not least regeneration after felling and cropping. High rainfall indeed ensures tropical forest, plant diversity, and large and old plants on the Solomons and the Fiji, Samoa, and Hawaiian groups. However, geology is also significant, with volcanic islands sometimes providing a poor habitat for vegetation, not least if there is also no fresh water. Isolated islands that are short of fresh water have less vegetation. A shortage of fresh water is a problem, for example, in the lowland parts of the islands. The small population on the Mexican island of Guadalupe depends on water brought in by tanker. The spread of animals and plant species was affected by isolation. As a result, animals and vegetation are often specific to individual islands, as in the Galapagos, the Bonin Islands, New Caledonia, and Norfolk Island, the last a particular instance of a Pacific temperate ecosystem. Wildlife is also very specific, for example, coconut crabs, the largest land invertebrates in the world. They are exported as food from the Polynesian island of Makatea. Birds were the animals that spread most easily to other islands, and the sole mammal in Polynesia, Micronesia, and Melanesia prior to the arrival of humans was the flying fox. In contrast, there were dingoes in Australia, while Hokkaido has the brown bear and the red fox. Stella's sea cow. An extinct Sirenian, or sea cow, like the manatee, this mammal could be up to 33 feet or 10 metres in length. Observed in 1741 on the Komandorski Islands on Bering's last expedition by the naturalist Georg Wilhelm Stella, after whom a sea eagle, jay, eider and sea lion are also named, the animal was hunted to extinction for food. It was possibly extinct by 1768, although there were alleged later sightings, such sightings being an aspect of the Pacific as a world of report and rumour. The hunting of animals for such purposes was also seen with whalers killing large numbers of turtles on the Galapagos Islands. A more benign consequence of isolation was the more limited spread of tropical diseases, notably malaria, than would otherwise have occurred, while yellow fever is absent. In World War II, however, non-local forces, both Allied and Japanese, were hit hard by disease. The most serious was malaria, especially on New Guinea, but dysentery, scrub, typhus, dengue fever, ringworm, hookworm, and black water fever all posed major problems. In 1943, Brigadier General Carroll of the American Army reported, "Malaria is the most potent enemy we have so far had to contend with in the Southwest Pacific area. It causes more losses and non-effectives than all other causes combined. Not only does it cause the actual loss of personnel for prolonged periods of time, but it also causes a great loss of efficiency of troops remaining with their organizations. Parasitic illnesses have been a persistent problem for islanders. Indeed, lymphatic filariasis or elephantiasis was eliminated only in the late 2010s in the Cook and Marshall Islands, Niue and Vanuatu. There are about 25,000 islands in the Pacific, but again this depends on definitions of the ocean, following a Western early 19th century designation that left out much of the northern Pacific. The islands are generally grouped in terms of Micronesia, Melanesia, and Polynesia. Micronesia, the Palau, Caroline, Mariana, and Marshall Islands of the Northwest Pacific, has close to 1,500 islands, but a land area of fewer than 1,000 square miles. Its people are ethnically similar to Polynesians. Melanesia in the Western Pacific, notably Fiji, New Caledonia, the New Hebrides, and the Solomons, contains islands of contrasting sizes, as well as differing ethnic populations. Far-flung Polynesia in the Southern and Central Pacific, which includes Samoa, Tahiti, and Tonga, is particularly engaged with the ocean, with fishing more important to its traditional culture than in Melanesia. Mineral resources. Although coal is worked in Australia, the Pacific is rich rather in mineral resources, especially nickel on New Caledonia, which also has chrome, cobalt, iron, gold, silver and copper, and copper on New Guinea, where the remote Octedi mine was opened in 1988, and where Panguna on Bougainville has the world's largest reserves. Despite potential oil and natural gas, notably in New Guinea, where oil is produced near Lake Kutubu, production is not much developed, but New Zealand benefits from geothermal energy. On the ocean edges, there is oil and gas extraction off California, Alaska, and the Russian Far East, as well as considerable potential for more extraction. Much of the ocean is deep, and as a result, the lowering of water levels during the freezing of the Ice Age did not lead to any significant extension of the coastline into the ocean. Lower California in Mexico and Southern California in the United States were modest exceptions, while the North and South Islands of New Zealand were joined, and there was a substantial land bridge between New Guinea and Australia, which was then linked to Tasmania. With the exception of Australasia, the principal differences in coastline were close to Asia, with Asia, Borneo, Sumatra, and Southeast Asia all joined, the Philippines likewise, the Japanese islands linked to the Asian mainland via Sakhalin, and both the Yellow Sea and the South China Sea land. There was no comparable case in the islands of Polynesia, Micronesia, and Melanesia, and thus, aside from the sea level falling, far less change there in the period at the close of the Ice Age. Nor did the Ice Age provide an opportunity for the movement of plants, animals, or humans into these Pacific islands, as occurred between Asia and North America. The threat to whales. In May 2021, HMAS Sydney, a guided missile destroyer exercising off San Diego, California, returned to harbour with bodies of two fin whales stuck to the hull. Indeed, up to 50 fin whales are struck by vessels annually off the west coast of the United States. The fin whales are vulnerable because they are large and also rest and sometimes feed near the surface. Oceans absorb most of the excess heat and much of the carbon dioxide from the Earth. As the largest ocean, the Pacific is both crucial to this process and also greatly affected by the warming of the climate. The warming of the Pacific makes it harder for cold and warm layers of water to mix, and as a result, the supply of oxygen and nutrients is greatly diminished. Indeed, the Pacific is losing oxygen and taking on excess carbon dioxide in its upper layers. This more acidic ocean is then an issue for life forms such as coral. More extreme climatic variations within this deteriorating pattern have also had an impact, and crucially are becoming more frequent. Thus, acute heat in Pacific North America in 2021 was linked to the death of hundreds of millions of marine creatures, including salmon. The physical environment, therefore, is not unstable only due to continental drift. International dateline. An agreed line through the Pacific that serves as the boundary between one calendar day and the next, the line runs roughly along the anti-meridian, the 180-degree line of longitude, but has detours to accord with particular territorial interests, thus swinging to the east to include Kiribati. Movements in the line have included Alaska, when it was purchased from Russia by America in 1867, while Samoa moved back to the west in 2011, in order to be in line with Australia and New Zealand. An Atlantic comparison. Size alone does not explain the differences between Atlantic and Pacific, differences that have interacted with human action to create the major contrasts between the two oceans. In large part, this is a matter of the interaction of the middle latitudes and the pace of settlement. By 1400, the islands in the middle latitudes of the Pacific were settled, and these societies were able to continue largely undisturbed by Westerners until the late 18th century. In contrast, in the Atlantic, there were fewer islands. Some were not settled prior to the arrival of Europeans, notably Madeira, the Azores, Bermuda, St. Helena and Ascension, and they were all more subject to Western pressure. In addition, Atlantic islands that were extensively settled, notably the Canaries and those in the Caribbean, were conquered, and there was a demographic revolution on them. Disease savaged indigenous populations, and the use of imported slaves to create a new workforce linked to provision for the new Western-run Atlantic economy ensured a European-African demographic world. This was different to that on the American landmass, where indigenous Americans continued to predominate, albeit with a significant Hispanic element and, in Brazil, an enslaved African dimension. There was no equivalent in the Pacific until the widespread arrival of Western settlers in the 19th century, either overland, as in North America, or by sea, as in Australasia, and to a degree in North America. This demographic movement from the West helped create a perception of the Pacific as those areas not settled by outsiders. But that approach was misleading, both as far as the situation then was concerned, and also more generally, because that account underplays the role of Asia, both historically, in terms of the origins of the movements of people into the area, and in terms of the continuing impact of Asian peoples and powers. This impact, moreover, remained an element, despite the size of the ocean, as with trans-Pacific population movements from the 19th century. At the same time, the very size of the Pacific ensured different links and also gradations of linkage within it, both to a degree not seen in the Atlantic. Chapter 2. The Indigenous World to 1513. The extent to which the Pacific saw significant development prior to the arrival of Europeans can be presented in different perspectives. This arrival is generally dated to the entry of Magellan's expedition in late 1520, but Vasco Núñez de Balboa, a Spanish explorer in 1513, had already crossed the Isthmus of Panama to the Pacific, defeating the divided indigenous peoples and claiming what he called Mar del Sur and the adjoining lands for Ferdinand and Isabella of Spain. He then used canoes to reach the Isla del Rey in a search for pearls. Subsequently, after his overthrow by Spanish rivals in 1514, Balboa was rehabilitated and named governor of the South Seas. In 1519, he built four ships on the Rio Balsas and sailed nearby Pacific waters, but his efforts were cut short that year when Spanish rivals overthrew and executed him, Although these rivals used his ships, they did not sail any great distance. In contrast, non-Europeans had been doing so for many years, although for a long time this was not apparent at all to the arriving Europeans. Indeed, the Polynesians had crossed vast tracts of the Pacific, an ocean whose distances put the Atlantic into the shade. The settling of the Pacific, including the movement into it of peoples from further west, was a complex process that has been illuminated by archaeological work. But there is much that is still open to debate, and discussion will doubtless continue as new research and fresh insights are assessed. As elsewhere in the world, the major change in sea levels during the Ice Ages played an important role in creating possibilities, although outcomes were not inevitable, a position that very much remains the case. The movement of archaic Papuans, sometimes referred to as Australoids, probably from the Andaman Islands in the Indian Ocean and then Sunda, the region of most of modern Indonesia, to Sahul, that of New Guinea, Australia and Tasmania, possibly occurred up to 60,000 years ago, with a short sea crossing from Timor, which was then part of the mainland of Sunda. The Sydney area was settled about 40 to 45,000 years ago. There was also movement from Sunda into New Guinea, although that was probably also settled by archaic Papuans who had already crossed from Timor to Australia. The subsequent pattern of population movements is unclear, not least because the later rise of the sea level when the Ice Ages ended led to the loss of archaeological material, and notably so in coastal areas. Nevertheless, the settlers moved around the coastal areas of both Australia and New Guinea, for example the Huon Peninsula on New Guinea, although there were also settlements inland in both. From about 40,000 years ago, although the nature of their watercraft is unclear, the archaic Papuans pressed on to islands east of New Guinea, first New Britain and Ireland, and then from about 24,000 BCE to Bougainville in the Solomon Islands. This remained an axis for the later movement of Austronesian peoples, although the pace of movement varied. Moreover, aside from this forward expansion of archaic Papuans, which attracts most attention, there was also much movement within Australia and New Guinea. The latter, indeed, showed a pattern of agricultural development that was to be repeated elsewhere. The clearing of dense forests by the archaic Papuans ensured that hunter-gathering could be supplemented by later Austronesians who brought crop cultivation, notably of taro from about 4000 BCE, and then by the domestication of pigs and dogs from about 3000 BCE. This represented an expansion of Asian agricultural and domestic techniques. The warmth and rainfall of New Guinea proved very good for crop cultivation. Separately, the rising sea level was part of the transformation of the geography of Sahul, a transformation that forced the need to respond to more coastlines, separated Tasmania about 9000 BCE, and cut the wide land bridge with Australia from about 8000 BCE. In the resulting Torres Strait Islands, an archaic Papuan culture based on the cultivation of yams and on fishing developed. Ground-down mollusk shells were used for fish hooks. They were also employed in mainland Australia, as was spearing. The maritime legacy is covered in the National Maritime Museum in Sydney. Originally from Southeast Asia, extending up to Taiwan, and probably spreading from Taiwan via the Philippines, the Austronesians assimilated earlier peoples and were to press on from the Bismarck Archipelago from about 1000 BCE to the Caroline Islands, where taro, cassava, sweet potato, bananas and coconuts were cultivated. From the eastern tip of New Guinea in about 2000 BCE, there was a move across the generally benign Coral Sea to New Caledonia. There, taro, cassava, yams and sweet potato were cultivated. From about 1500 BCE, there was movement along the Solomons to the Santa Cruz Islands, northern Vanuatu and Fiji. For example, the far-flung northern Vanuatan Islands were settled between 1100 and 700 BCE. In what was a long crossing, a separate movement from the Philippines reached the Marianas from about 1500 BCE, where taro, cassava, rice, bananas, and coconuts were cultivated. This was the basis for the Chamorro people with their sacmans, sailing outriggers. Polynesian society emerged from about 1000 CE in Fiji, Tonga, and Samoa. This society proved extremely dynamic and able, both psychologically and practically, to overcome vast distances. Although there has been extensive debate on these points, the Lapita pottery that was used makes it possible to suggest both a distinctive culture and a chronology of spreading settlement. Probably from the Samoa group in about 830 CE, there was, genetic sequencing published in 2021 would suggest, a migration to Rarotonga, the largest of the Cook Islands, and from there to Tahiti in about 1050, the South Marquesas in about 1140, and the North Marquesas in about 1330. Archaeological sites include those of the Taipivai Valley on Nuku. Oral traditions, for example that for the Tonga island of Ata, present clashes between indigenous aboriginal and later settlers, but it is unclear how widespread this situation was. The tense situation in Borneo in the early 2020s, for example, may be a guide to past circumstances, but the context was different. Polynesian knowledge. A map of 1769, Tupaia's map, was an attempt to present on paper the geographical knowledge of the Tahitian priest Tupaia, around 1725 to 1770. 74 islands were named and depicted, including those of the Austral, Marquesas, and Society groups. James Cook and Joseph Banks were very interested in Polynesian navigation and knowledge of the ocean, and Banks had a map made of the list provided by Tupaia, who joined Cook's first voyage and provided navigational and linguistic help. Tupaia died of dysentery in Jakarta en route to London. Nearly half of the islands in the list have not been identified, probably due to difficulties in understanding the Tahitian language and locations, while Tupaia's knowledge was presumably weaker for more distant islands. Conversely, the Cartesian grid of the Europeans could make little of the space-time complexities of Polynesian understanding, with their roles for the relationships between human ancestors and environmental elements. The genetic sequencing indicates that the Palliser were settled in about 1110, Mangareva in about 1130, and Rapa Iti, Aitutaki, and Mauke in about 1190. Mangareva proved the base for a move, presumably via the Pitcairn Islands, possibly in the 12th century or about 1210 CE, to Rapa Nui, Easter Island, although pollen and linguistic evidence has also been used to argue for 600 or 700 CE. The Cooks were the basis for migration to New Zealand, whence the Chatham Islands were settled. The Kermadec Islands were probably settled from Tahiti. There may have been at least one voyage from New Zealand to the Ross Ice Shelf in Antarctica, as in Maori fable, but this is based solely on oral lore, the legend of Uite Rangiora, located in about 650, which speaks of a place of bitter cold where rock-like structures arose from a solid white sea, and also speaks of snow. Although the Maori visited the subantarctic islands, there is no physical or archaeological evidence to confirm this story, and it is highly dubious. However, what the legend may preserve is the site of a large detached iceberg surrounded by sea ice. These have certainly come far north in recent decades, while voyaging far south may not have been cold during the medieval temperature optimum. In separate migrations, the Hawaiian group was reached in about 400 CE, while the Fiji group was the basis for an advance by 500 CE via Kiribati to the Marshall Islands, while there was an earlier move from New Ireland to the Caroline Islands. As a result of these voyages, and crucially settlements, by 1350 CE, many of the Pacific Islands, or at least island groups, were inhabited. Hawaii, New Zealand, and Easter Island were the apparent extremes of the Polynesian Triangle. Sources for ancient Polynesia. The human history of Polynesia is shorter than that for other regions, as, bar Antarctica, it was the last area on Earth to be reached by humans. This proximity to the present should make the history easier to assess, but that is not the case due to the lack of a written language and therefore any written records. Oral stories are important and have been used with particular effect in work on Maori history, while archaeology expanded most as a source in recent decades before the development of genomic research. Archaeology is a matter not only of the direct human trace, but also of impact in the sense of evidence from pollen, skeleton remains, tree trunks, and pond sediments. Radiocarbon dating has helped provide enhanced data on settlement dates. The radiocarbon dating of the pollen layers of sediment cores in Oahu in the Hawaiian group reveals the early presence of the lo'ulu, a tall palm with edible nuts, only for this indigenous palm, as well as other indigenous trees, to decline, possibly because of human deforestation, the transformation of forests into taro farms, and the eating of the palm nuts by the Polynesian rats that accompanied the settlers. These settlers were presumably responsible for the marked decline of creatures whose habitats were in the forests that were cleared, notably indigenous snails and flightless geese and ducks, which also would have provided a source of food. Archaeological work, however, can also lead in different directions, as in very different evaluations of the start of settlement on the Tongan island of Atta. Designed by the Norwegian Thor Heyerdahl to show that Easter Island, Rapa Nui, could have been settled from South America, and therefore that Polynesia could have been settled from the east rather than the west, as suggested earlier, the Kon-Tiki expedition of 1947 indicated that such links were indeed possible. Named after the Inca god Viracocha, also known as Kon-Tiki, the raft was built out of balsa logs and set out from Callao in Peru, although it had to be towed from the coast in order to escape the powerful Humboldt currents. The raft travelled about 4,340 miles, mostly drifting, before beaching in the Tuamotus. Yet, as genetic and linguistic research have established, the settlement was certainly from the west, with Polynesia looking to the Malay world for language, crops, animals, tools, and canoes. The expedition, however, contributed to the role of the ocean as a focus for stories. Knowledge of trans-Pacific contacts comes from several major sources. The key ones are archaeological evidence, the reconstruction of genetic lineages, linguistic and technological indicators, and oral tradition, including the reconstruction of traditions and technologies of long-distance voyaging. Archaeological evidence solidly suggests that the very early colonization and settlement by sea in the Western Pacific and along the Pacific shore of the Americas started as far back as at least 19,000 years ago on the eastern shore, from where humans moved south as far as Chile, and upwards of 50,000 years ago in the southwest Pacific. For Polynesia, genetic patterning caused by the founder effect, in which genetic diversity becomes less marked with each successive colonization, has helped to establish the sequence of settlement, although the timing is necessarily by generations, not years. The reasons for Polynesian expansion are suggestive rather than definitive. The obvious factor may appear to be the need for land, and in particular for good land, as opposed to the marginal opportunities that might have been all that was on offer to those seeking to establish themselves in islands under population pressure. Equally, existing settlements might have been affected by a reduction in soil fertility, arising in part from a lack of fertilizer, from rainwater-produced leaching on lands cleared of vegetation, and from the heavy demands for nutrients of crops. Most societies responded accordingly with slash and burn practices, but the opportunities for these were limited on many islands, as well as by slopes and soils that were inappropriate for cultivation. Deforestation on Easter Island, Rapa Nui. Easter Island appears to have demonstrated the precarious nature of Pacific environments, a nature that could stem from a variety of often overlapping causes, including low rainfall, little fresh water, and poor soils. Vulnerability to human action and to animals, plants, and pathogens introduced by outsiders could also be a factor, and was increased by both population rises and greater connectivity. On Easter Island, the increase in the human population may have been a major cause of deforestation, although that has also been linked to religious practices. At any rate, less timber affected the availability of boats for fishing, putting pressure on agriculture as a source of food, with control over land becoming a more significant cause of clan feuds. Origin traditions. The British missionary, William Ellis, who spent 1816 to 1824 in the Tahiti and Hawaii groups, noted the tradition that the first inhabitants of the South Sea Islands originally came from a country in the direction of the setting sun, to which, they say, several names were given, though none of them are remembered by the present inhabitants. In turn, the genetic lineages of the sweet potato, Ipomoea batatas cultivars, and archaeological remnants around the Pacific strongly suggest that Polynesian voyages brought at least one sweet potato lineage from the Americas back to the Pacific Islands and eventually all the way to New Zealand around 1,000 years ago, with a rapid diversification, therefore, on the various islands of Polynesia. That was Heyerdahl's hypothesis, but the circumstantial evidence suggests that Polynesian voyagers made the contacts and not Andean voyagers. Meanwhile, recent research has indicated that the hypothesis that the sweet potato sailed on its own rafts of vegetation or was derived from wild Ipomoea species on the Pacific Islands is highly unlikely. As a separate instance of diffusion, Spanish voyagers brought another lineage of sweet potato west across the Pacific in the late 16th century. It then made its way via exchange all the way into the highlands of New Guinea and Taiwan within two centuries. The ancient DNA of Amerindians from what is now Colombia has been found in Polynesians from the Marquesas, which suggests direct human interchange and sex between these two regions, again about 1,000 years ago. This is the strongest piece of evidence for interhemispheric exchange before the voyage of Magellan in 1519 to 1521. No Polynesian objects and settlements have been yet found in the Americas, analogous to the Norse objects and settlements discovered in Labrador, or vice versa. However, the presence of the sweet potato in archaeological deposits, plus the new human genetic evidence, is very difficult to explain without presuming ancient transhemispheric contact. It is also highly implausible that Polynesian voyagers, as skilled and adventurous as they were, would stop at Easter Island, Rapa Nui, or the Chatham Islands, and fail to venture on, however briefly, to the continental coasts of South America and Australia when they had already sailed so far. There are apparently linguistic remnants of Polynesian visitors in Amerindian languages. The migrations posed formidable challenges, not least of navigation, seamanship, and supply. There is an extensive scholarly literature now on ancient voyaging between the islands. It is supported by archaeological evidence and some fascinating sailing experiments using traditional techniques between the Pacific Islands. Drawing on the role of the maritime cultures of Southeast Asia in the confluence of ideas about shipbuilding, the Polynesians used double-hulled canoes that could carry up to 70 people and supplied themselves with fish they caught and rainwater, while also having supplies in the shape of the food they took with them, including pigs, a prime source of protein, chickens, and dogs. The boats, with their parallel hulls linked by crossbeams or platforms, were flexible and could be propelled by rowing, sail, or a combination of the two. There were differences in boats between particular areas. For example, Fijian plank-built druas with their second hulls rather than outriggers were particularly...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.